Everybody get up.
Hi, I'm Tony Maserati, and I'm speaking to you here from La Fabrique in Saint-Rémy, France. Beautiful studio. And I'm going to answer some questions from the internet today. The first question is from Gabriel Conti. Hi, Tony. Thanks for doing this. You're welcome. When you send a mix to a client not attending in this session, do you do some kind of mastering work to level match your mix to a finished record? I do some work to level match my mix closer to what is typically delivered for both rough mixes these days and for mastering. I tend to use different things, but generally they're all digital. In my analog summing bus chain, I do have a Shadow Hills mastering compressor, a Chandler curve bender EQ, and a pendulum PL2 transient limiter. Those three things kind of control things quite well, but for me to bring the level up to where people are typically used to hearing things, I use the Slate FGX, I use an L2, I use an L2007, quite a few different, I'll try quite a few different things. But the answer is yes, I do bring the level up. Next question, Harris Garalakis. Hi, Mr. Maserati. What is the first mix of yours that was a game changer for your career? This is an interesting question because I thought, well, maybe it's the first mix that I ever heard on the radio. I did a mix that was probably not very good that the clients accepted, luckily for me, and I heard it on the radio. And in some ways, that mix was a game changer in the sense that it kept me going. It satisfied a personal goal that I set for myself. And I think the name of the song was Naughty Girls Need Love Too by Samantha Fox. I have to admit there are further game changers in my life because, you know, I worked on another mix with Devante from Jodeci, who produced a song with Mary J. Blige and Casey from Jodeci. And because of that mix, I got close to Mary and started working with her and did some work on her first record and continue working on her next three records. So, you know, kind of depends on how you define game changer, but I'd say that the early mixes I did for Mary were certainly game changers and solidified my relationship with Bad Boy and as a real mixer in the R&B and hip hop community in New York at that time. This comes from Dalink Wen. Hi Tony, when mixing a track, especially the drums, do you use a bus compressor to tighten the overall drum group before routing it to the submix and a bus compressor on the submix to tighten the entire mix? In regards to gain staging, what is the highest peak on your mix bus before you send it off to mastering? I'll start with the end of the question first, which is I tend to go as hot as I possibly can before clipping. You know, again, my PL2 in my chain will help control some of that. Obviously, I'm trying to get the hottest level I can before I'm clipping, and I try not to send any overdriven or distorted or clipped files to mastering. As far as my mix bus goes, or my submix regarding the drums, I tend to use a parallel aux or parallel bus, and I will do some pretty drastic compression on that. And then I send that to a submix that then I can do a little more squashing with, sometimes with the UAD on the parallel side. I'll probably end up using an Allen Smart C2 for that drum compression parallel. And then on the drum group, quite often I'll use a UAD mastering, the Shadow Hills mastering compressor, or I'll use could use an L1 from Waves. I've also been known to use the Maserati group plugin, which I like quite a lot and made for that specific purpose. So I hope that helps. Carlos Catu, hi Tony, do you have any sample rate preference, and do you notice a substantial difference while working on higher sample rates? There is a difference in working on higher sample rates, and certainly there is a more defined low frequency, and the high frequency certainly extends beyond the typical 44.1. I do find, however, the drag on my CPU at higher sample rates is problematic. I have less voices, and that causes more difficulty than I feel it's worth. I tend to work primarily in 44.1 or 48. I don't work on jazz or classical, which I think perhaps it'll be a little more valid to use higher sample rates for. And I also kind of like the crunch that I get out of 44.1. Whatever the crunch means, actually. Alex Medrano. Hi, Tony. Do you find parallel compression useful for almost any genre, especially on drums? I'm mixing jazz for the first time, and I'm still looking for that jazzy sound. I use parallel compression on the genres I work in, which are R&B, hip-hop, pop, and the varieties of pop that there are. And I use parallel compression for a variety of things. I'll use it just on a bass, perhaps, in one song. I'll split the bass, or I'll send it out to an aux and then blend it back in. I'll do that with compression or without. As far as parallel compression for the drums, I tend to do it, as I just mentioned, using a parallel aux picking and choosing which drums and how much of each drum or overhead or sampled drums I'm going to send to that Allen Smart C2. So I use it quite often, and I use it on randomly whatever I feel is needing some support. I tend to use parallel compression to hold things up, but I still get a little bit of variation and dynamic from the natural sound and the original drums. Basically, if I've got a dynamic that moves like this, if I add the parallel, it just makes the dynamic slightly less dramatic. That's kind of the idea. Wanfi Rem, hi Tony, which recommendation can you give us to improve the low end in a mix, and where do you start to work on it? I think the low end is in almost every track, right? Except for cymbals, for the most part. But all the tracks, I mean, I consider low end to be anything below 500 hertz. So I am controlling that low end in various ways, both with equalization, compression, with parallel compression, with saturation, So I will do anything I can, and again, the operative word is control. I'm not trying to necessarily reduce, but control the lower frequencies in the mix. And I tend to use, when you use the word, give us to improve the low end in a mix, of course it depends on the mix itself and the song. If it is a fast song, the low end shouldn't last too long. Perhaps your bass or your kick drum is holding a note too long, and that's it's making the bottom end less defined. If you are using 808s and you have punch kicks along with them, sometimes the 808 will cloud the extra punch kicks if it lasts too long. All the lower frequencies are working with each other, and as the mixer, you're the one who has to make them work well together. Otherwise, they're just going to do whatever they want and decide who's going to dominate. So it's our job as mixers to try to figure out which one we want, and we decide to be the dominant or to carry the low frequency. Certainly, the voice has a considerable amount of low frequency, so we have to make sure that we have a little bit of room left for that, depending on what register the voice is in. Stephen LaRosa has a question here. I understand why you use different summing mixers on each part of the mix, but could you go into detail about why you use specific summing mixers with those specific elements? I use different summing mixers in some ways similar to how you may have heard other mixers use the A, B, and C bus on an SSL. The A bus, they have a particular insert with an EQ and a compressor on it, and the B bus is a different setup with a different EQ and compressor, or maybe there's a limiter. And the C bus might be something, say, that's more transparent and cleaner. It's exactly the same idea. That's exactly what I do. I have three summing buses, basically, and I choose which elements I send to those summing buses. Now I can send a single element to all three if I so desire, which of course is what you can do with an SSL and the A, B, and C bus. So I am picking and choosing each bus, and in my case it's a Neve, small Neve Melbourne, an EMI mini mixer, and a Fulcrum passive summing mixer. I am thinking about adding maybe the Fat Bastard, I've heard is really good, and someone told me about a transformer, a mixer that has transformers on the ins and outs. I thought that might be interesting to try as well. So I'm looking for coloration, and that's why I use the different summing amps, the summing mixers. There are other reasons to sum externally, which obviously, as you say, you've heard me talk about and you've heard others talk about. In the box, we've all gotten used to, and I use it quite often, but I am still very much used to using external summing because I understand it better. Sergio Cavallari, how much time do you spend on a mix usually, and do you have any secret to delivering it faster? I don't have any secrets because I'm not fast. I am the slowest mixer out of everyone who shows up at La Fabrique. I generally take 2 days. I do because I tend to live with it and I tend to work through a variety of materials. So by materials I mean I bounce between songs, especially if I'm working on more than one song for an artist. On those rare occasions, which are not so rare anymore, when a client insists on having a quick delivery and turnaround time, of course I do my best to get it to them in a short period of time. A lot of it depends on what's delivered to me. If the tracks are in great shape and well recorded, well produced, well arranged, everything stands up, everything works well together, sometimes it's just taking in another 10%. Other times I have to take it 85% of the way. So it really depends. Ron Entwistle says, why is collaboration important and why are you so successful at it? Thanks for the question, Ron. I kind of preach collaboration. And it's, you know, the real answer is quite simple. I was never a great player. And if you're not a great player, you need other people. But I realized that was both a blessing and a curse because it pushed me to collaborate and to have production partners and to rely on musicians to be creative with me. And it forced me to realize that what I have to offer is taste and perspective and a experience on how things have worked in my life, as well as how things work in a mix, or how things work in any production. Collaboration to me comes from everywhere. It comes from the A&R person, the artist, the musicians involved, the producer, of course. It comes from the people in the room at the time any part of the production is happening. Everyone who attends a session is part of the sound of that session. Certainly in my studio, where I frequently ask my colleagues and other producers and writers in the building to come in and lend me their ear, as I say, so that I can get their opinion about a direction I'm going on, or making sure that my references on the radio for this particular song are correct. Collaboration is in every way part of music. Any piece of classical work has collaboration built into it. The composer, the musician, the conductor, obviously the musicians, depending on how many there are, together. It's the same with any production. I think that it also, collaboration ensures longevity. If you are working by yourself in a vacuum and have a tremendous amount of success, I guarantee you that success will wane. There will come a time when your sound will become stale to the consumer. If you implement a methodology of always bringing in collaborators, you will ensure a longer shelf life, a longer work life for yourself, and you will also have a more rich working environment.